one of the more dreaded days of life, we're here to bring to an end the life of Cynthia Darlene Phillips. She obviously meant different things to each one of us, but to each one of us, she personified love and friendship. And in that memory, and in that knowing of love and friendship, a special song has been selected that I think we can all relate to, and that we all yearn to see and to hear one final day.
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, where I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. Gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. Shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness, this world we stumble through, all these questions I can't answer, and so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace.
This small group of people gathered out here today is an incredibly small, minute representation of the lives and people that Cynthia Phillips touched. This is just a select group of people that Cynthia wanted to come and share in her release from this earth, more so due to not wanting to cause trouble or despair to friends feeling an obligation to travel miles away. It can certainly be viewed as an act of sincere kindness and concern. I think it's very fitting to start this eulogy of Cynthia's out with something that my Aunt Catherine Good shared with me, and certainly in light of the fact that Catherine and my mother, Catherine's sister, were the ones to really lead Cynthia to the gate of God's door. And what this is, I want us all to realize what cancer cannot do. It cannot cripple love. It cannot shatter hope. It cannot corrode faith. It cannot destroy peace. It cannot kill friendship. It cannot suppress memories. It cannot silence courage. It cannot invade the soul. It cannot steal eternal life. It cannot conquer the spirit. Why can cancer not do these things when seemingly it can destroy any life it comes in contact with? Why? Why is because God made all these things, love, hope, faith, peace, friendship, memories, courage, soul, life, and spirit. God made those things available to all who believe in Him. And what God creates and what God gives, nothing can destroy. Cynthia Phillips came into being on July the 7th, 1967. The day of her birth, no doubt, was a joy to her mother, Joan, her dad, Jimmy. Joan told me that by 6 weeks of age, Cynthia was sleeping through the night and was, by all measures, was a perfect baby. Through her childhood, never causing her any trouble, always doing what she was supposed to do, seemingly always doing it with a happy heart. At 6 years of age, she was selected as the Landrum High School mascot for the graduates of that year. They selected her cute, smiling, Barbie little face to be the mascot to escort those graduates into their graduation. Also at 6 years of age, she became a big sister to Brother Brian. No doubt watching over him, caring for him, and being a big sister. A little later in life, she learned gymnastics and the graceful movements of the body that are required to be a gymnast. She carried that grace throughout life. Most anything she done, most all things she done, you could see in her ways of movement and in her life, you could see discipline, you could see focus. in her teenage years, like most, she earned a driver's license, had a little MG midget that she used in a way that most big sisters would refrain from or would really hate to do. And that being to haul her little brother Brian and friend Eric Nodine around, drive them to school, drive them to skating rinks across various states, even taking some dangerous trips over some jumps and hills. And what Brian told me, had the brakes in that finely crafted MG had failed, they would have surely wound up in the sewer pit there in Landrum. But these were all parts of Cynthia's life. You know, at this point, she was already enjoying life, experiencing life, sharing that life with her brother, showing love to brother. A lot of girls 6 years their elder of their brother would probably say, get away from me, I'm going out with my friends. But Cynthia, she remained true to Brian throughout life. She had a unique ability to laugh at herself when things didn't go right or when she would mess up or do something wrong. I remember many times when she would say words wrong or misspeak, and she'd laugh it off. About 17 years of age, a boy, 7 years her senior, come calling. Once again, she turned to her brother, this time not to give him advice, but to ask advice. And she asked him, she said, I've got this guy named Quain and some other guy that wanting to take me out. Which one do you think I should go with, Brian? Well, at one point I thought about saying, well, Brian, you must have told her wrong, but apparently you told her right. Her and Quain began quite a love affair from that day. Their first date was to a drag race, of which Cynthia had no idea what was going on. She actually thought they were going to a round track race, for that was really the only kind of racing she knew existed. I think maybe once or twice she'd been to a dirt track race with her mom and dad. But little did she know, she was being introduced to what not only would become the man of her life, but also the sport that would become their lives. She was young and quite naive, but she seemed to have what some would call street smarts. And I can remember that. I can remember Quain telling me, boy, she's hard to get next to. She was just smart. I can remember her saying to Quain, when he was trying to be smooth and impress her, I heard her say it many times, that's just drunk talk. Again, a little bit of street smarts mixed in with that naivety of a 17-year-old girl. She and Quain became inseparable. They were each other's rock for 37 years. Sure, they had bumps in the road. We all do. It's not a relationship. It's not love if you don't. Those bumps are meant to challenge and to test that love. That's what they're for. They prove, if you make it through it, that you're the right ones for one another. Out of those 37 years of loving and racing, she only missed being at Quain's side and being out the windshield serving as a backup girl at two events out of 37 years. That's an impressive commitment to each other. Very impressive. Cynthia never was the loudest voice in the room. She wasn't that. Quite frankly, she would be usually sitting quietly in the back of the room somewhere. But astonishingly, she was always listening, and she made many, many lasting friendships throughout life, being the quiet one, not the loud one. And that really in and of itself is quite unique, that she would be remembered, respected, and noticed while really not saying much to people. She was quiet, shy, kept herself, but she just had an aura. She just had an open heart, I guess. In that racing world, there was a couple of guys, D. Bragg, Greg Waldrop, that were by her and Quain's side for 13 long racing years. They referred to her as sis, and no doubt they loved her as a sister, and I have no question that she loved them as brothers. She was incredibly frugal with money. She would shop for herself and Quain at Goodwill and other discount stores to prevent the needless spending of money. Which reminds me, everybody, we need to sell our stock in Goodwill. She visited it just about every other day. Around 2010, I think the greatest challenge for Quain and Cynthia was formed when this word Southeast Gassers Association came about, came to be heard. What a challenge for a relationship that was. Fortunately, they had a racing relationship as much as they had a loving relationship. And I have no question that Cynthia embraced that challenge the same as Quain. I know as a fact that she done her part. I know she supported him, and maybe he even supported her. Maybe she was more the driving force than any of us will ever know. But the point of it is, no one ever expected, namely me, no one ever expected that a shy little lady would rise up as one of the biggest known drivers in all of the Sega. A lot of characters out there, there's a lot of drivers. But I'm here to tell you, there was as many flower power shirts and souvenirs and things out there as you would find on anybody. Put a clip on Facebook of two or three little girls commenting to the fact on how Cynthia was the one that was going to win that race, and she was cool, and how excited they was to get to meet her. She left impressions on those three girls that may well last a lifetime, and many others, without question, positive impressions. It was only took a couple of racing seasons for the flower power entry to become a force to be reckoned with. As a racer, I was impressed, truly impressed. I would talk with Quain about her methods on the starting line, just like in gymnastics. They truly were smooth and graceful. What you don't see in 90% of the so-called professional drivers out there. As she became more and more competitive and starting to win rounds, it come time for her to stop by my way and do interviews with me. And she reverted back to that shy little lady again. I can remember I would ask her questions and put the microphone in her face, and she would look at me real pitiful, like, what do I say? What am I supposed to do? But with that, like all things, she started to loosen up, come out of her shell, and was actually become a pretty good interviewer. interviewee. As time went on, she became more and more professional in her life and in her racing. And one day, we all got that dreaded word, cancer. While enduring an ever-increasing pain that I don't think any of us can acknowledge or witness or recognize, comprehend, she elected to continue racing. But amazingly, she continued to improve. And I personally think her last year was her best year. She went to the finals, 2-3 races, won many rounds. She was seriously entering into the second part of her life. But cancer ultimately brought an end to that, sadly. She wanted to win a race. I know she did. But in that, she decided to hand it over to a much younger version of herself. Her niece, Alexis, in the hopes that Flower Power would be just that. David and Pam Burrell, the two of you, made so many memories with Quayne and Cynthia. And like best friends, you were both there through it all, good and bad. Zeke and Barb being outside the family, the immediate family, but were so instrumental in Cynthia's life. Y'all were the kind of people that Cynthia knew she could depend on, no matter what. She knew y'all would be there for her. Obviously, she knew her family was there, her mom, her brother, sister-in-law. But when you step outside the family, it's always a unique situation. It is certainly notable that the last friendship she made was with Katie Jackson, a woman that came into Cynthia's life again via racing. It's amazing what God brought to Cynthia through them old race cars. But according to Quayne, Cynthia took an unusual and immediate liking to Katie, as Katie so selflessly put her life aside and assisted Cynthia and family whenever needed. Her last great act of kindness was to leave her loved ones knowing that she was no longer in pain and that she was going to enter into the gates of God's magnificent glory, to where we would know that she would never be in pain again. And to that, I think that was Cynthia Darlene Phillips' shining moment in life. That was her last act of love, not only for herself, that she wanted to spend life in eternity, but she also wanted to spend her eternal life with loved ones that I'm sure went ahead of her and found their way into God's glorious heaven as well. One of the last things she said to me is, "I'm going to see Old Blue." And Cynthia, tell him hello. We love you. We love him. We love all that has gone before us. And we seek and we yearn to join you one beautiful day when God's face we do see.
Mm-hmm. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Yonder I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll
is called up yonder, I'll be there.
I can tell you this, that about 3-4 weeks ago, when my mother, Cynthia's mother-in-law, and mom's sister came over and shared God's word and God's grace with Cynthia, she had asked, Cynthia had, that someone come and talk with her about this, that she was concerned about where she would spend eternity, that she knew about God, but she wanted to know that she was going to go see his face. I can tell you from my own experience that after that took place and Cynthia accepted God into her heart and God indeed came into her heart, I know this because of what she told me. That at that moment, Cynthia's entire view of life changed. All her years of living, her view of life at that moment changed. And it changed in this way. I want you all to imagine sitting here right now with Cynthia knowing with certainty what she knows now. If she could come back down here and tell you, I want you to imagine for a moment what she would say. And with that, I'd like to go into prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you in Jesus Christ's holy name. You tell us that where two or more of us gather in your name, then so shall you be there also. So God, we are here gathered in your name, and we desire your presence. We need your touch. We need your love. We need your grace. We need your assurance, Father, as mankind's mind can only go so far. It is a faith-based religion, not a fact-based. So we need you, Father. We need to know that you're with us, to comfort us and guide us, not only today, but for the rest of the days of our life. We know because we believe in you, Father, and we believe in your promise of eternal life, that Cynthia is the one of the newest flowers in your garden. And we know that she is in your loving care. Jesus Christ, we pray to you once again to love and to hold, to keep and comfort our sister, our lover, our friend, until we can join her in your paradise. Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Now, if you have imagined what Cynthia may say to you, I'm going to read a Bible verse, and with that, I'm going to tell you how you too can be saved in God's blood if you aren't. Jesus told Nicodemus, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That verse is John chapter 3, verse 3. Remember that. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. We cannot get there through no good deed we do. Nothing man can do to be worthy of the glory of heaven. Nothing. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. Nothing. Except by the grace of God. How can you be born again? It is my firm belief, if Cynthia had the ability, this is what she would say to you. It's beyond belief, friends. It is the most glorious thing that you could ever, ever imagine. And above all, it's real. It's not a myth. God, heaven, paradise, and hell is real. So how do you become born again? First, you must have the desire. Second, you must truly believe and commit in the next few words. Dear Lord Jesus, you should say these. I realize that I am a sinner and I have broken your laws. I understand that my sin has separated me from you. I am sorry, and I ask you to forgive me. I accept the fact that your Son, Jesus Christ, died for me. Was resurrected and is alive today and hears my prayers. I now open my heart's door, dear Jesus, and invite you in. It really is that simple. But it ain't a joke. It's nothing to play with. And as a born-again Christian, you'll never be perfect. None of us will ever be perfect. We will fail. We will continue to live in sin. But there's that tug at your heart. It's that knowing that you've done wrong and that feeling and that need and desire to repent for that sin is when you know that the Father, the Holy Spirit, is living in you. It ain't just something that we as humans know for right from wrong. It ain't that. It's a true thing that God, only God, can produce and nurture. And with that, I think that would be what Cynthia would say to each and every one of us from her perch high above in the pearly gates, walking on the streets of gold. Friends, family, lovers, please, heed my warning. Heed God's warning. Let Him into your heart and come live in eternity in paradise with me. Amen.
What you will see today is a Trinity release. And a Trinity release consists of a flock of four white doves. Three doves will be released together as a flock from the white heart-shaped basket on the table in front of you. Three because of the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They will be a visible sign of God's presence. And the symbolism behind the Trinity release is very simple. It's simply the soul joining with God and making its ascent to heaven. Three snow-white doves, pure as love, represent the Holy Trinity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Joining them, another dove, the soul departed, a flock of angels, rising skyward into the heavens, free in flight. Together, they journey home. Look homeward, angels. We see them go. Farewell. Fly on. We loved you so.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. More weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, away. Yeah, when I die, hallelujah, by and by.